All right, let's go to the website.
Yeah.
That's where we're going first. Let me get rid of this thing.
Let me clean this up, yeah.
I don't want anyone to see my
shame. Let's hide the...
My shame. Okay.
Open source stuff. Okay. Yeah, okay. So let's go. Okay, let's scroll down.
Yeah, we're going to start...
At the bottom.
We're going to start at the beginning.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at the bottom, keep going, down, one more. No, okay, yes, it. Okay, Raspberry Pi Touch Display 2. This is coming soon. We just got them in. We have to like count them, weigh them, take photos, put them in stock. This is a really nice IPS display. 720 by 1280. Technically, this is it's a tablet display, so it's portrait, but I'm almost like positive you can rotate it in the software to make it landscape as well. But it's a very adorable little 5-inch tablet. Your Raspberry Pi can stick on the back. You use the cable that it comes with. Every Raspberry Pi after the Pi 2 or the Pi 3 that has a DSi or CSI cable works. It doesn't work with the Pi Zeros because it doesn't have a display connector, but every other Pi, it works great. And they also have like software ready to go. So you get it both in terminal and, non-light desktop graphics mode.
Okay. And then
next up, we have three boards from Unexpected Maker. We're still stocking their old version. This is a new version and it's like different enough that it's a new product. So this is the D series of the Feather S3. I don't remember the other name, like the Mini S3 and the Pro S3. Really great, Feather and other dev boards. Unexpected Maker makes awesome designs with lots of flash, lots of PS RAM. And this one, what's cool is they added. I'm not good at clicking. Maybe you can.
Well, this is a weird mouse.
That's a weird mouse. Yeah. If you look at the right there, there's two antennas. There's a UFL antenna and an onboard chip antenna. And there's a little switch in the middle. And that switch can be selected to change whether you want to have internal or external antennas. So like oftentimes when I make Feather boards, I'll have a version with a WFL or with a built-in antenna. This one, you can actually select which one you want on the fly, even if you want, which is really neat. They still have like those, dual I2C with power selection and, battery charging and lots of GPIO and everything. So let's just... We'll quickly go. So this is the Feather version.
Yeah.
And if you go back, there is the Pro, which has like tons of pins available. It's a little skinnier, but also has that switchable antenna. And it's a castellated, you can like solder it down, just super cool. And the Teeny, which is a little itsy bitsy, has fewer pins, but is, definitely minimized. Still has like I think on the back, there's a battery port you can solder on if you want. Like this is a little thing you used to do on the Trinkies, and you can connect a JST cable. But people really love the S3 chip. This comes with flash and PS RAM, which is so cool in a small package, and a switchable antenna. So great, great if you're like, I don't know if I need a big antenna or I want to use a little one. You don't have to choose anymore.
Then we've got a snap-on closure for the Resistor fixture.
Yeah, this Resistor fixture, which we use every day because our kids' video monitor does not do proper CC charging. This little case that it just protects it because I did have to, the plug is, it's a little, it can bend.
I have one.
Yeah, it bends. So we're going to pick up some of these for you.
No, actually, you know what? If you want to share it. It does. And this is me using it for like 6 months and being brutal. It still didn't break, by the way.
Look like, on the over. Yeah, it does. Yeah, it does still work. But if you see, it's a little bit bent because we don't have the protector.
And yeah, like our kid has stepped on it. I've ran it over.
Yeah. It does have like through board mounts, but they're still not, it's meant to be in a case where the plug is protected. Anyways, now we have a case that makes that easy.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Just reprint it. Okay.
And then let's go back to the...
next up is one of your favorites. We have these extremely cool ultra skinny cables, which you really dig. Actually,
this is
You show them and I'll grab the samples. I have them over here.
Yeah, so you can get these in all different lengths and you can do customizations if you want. This, I think, gives you kind of everything you need. And like I needed to chain a bunch of things together and just it had to be as small as possible. And I was using USB-C to connect a variety of wearables together and then a power supply. And then it just got to the point where I'm just like, all I need is the connector and the cable itself. And that was even giving it a structure to do things off of. So
yeah, let's go to the overhead. I'll show.
Yeah.
I'll show one of these because JP pointed this out. He was doing a project where he had to have a very compact, thin connectivity. And I was like, well, like I mentioned in IMPI, so much stuff is USB-C for power, video,
it does everything.
Connecting. So these are really skinny, but what I like is these contacts, these plugs here, even though they're thin, there's a little groove. So it's really easy to like grab this with your finger and pull it out. And the cable is super slim and flexible. So it'll fit through anything. You can also bunch it up easily. So it's like compared to your standard USB-C cables, which don't get me wrong, they're great. They can do like, you know, whatever, 3-5 amps.
Oh, you know what? The hand got it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got to turn off.
Because I lit with my hand?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's okay.
Can you turn it?
Yeah, the robot kind of likes to stare at people.
That's okay.
We have a local only non-cloud
too smart
face
robot.
Recognition thing and hand recognition.
Anyways,
oh, you know what? I wonder if it recognized the hand on the screen.
Oh, maybe.
Who knows?
Who knows, man? So yeah, and then of course, you know, this little ultra tiny one. So basically, like a lot of people are doing builds where they have like a feather and it's connected to a power pack, or maybe it's a Raspberry Pi connected to a portable. Da, da, da. So you want to have like a super skinny connector.
Like portable router.
So for your router, you can now get these super slim cables. They do have USB power delivery capability. The CC pins are connected. They do work both ways. They do have data and, you know, they have charge and sync. They don't have like Thunderbolt, obviously, but they're not rated, but I think you could probably do like, I think I said 45 or 65 watts. It's probably fine.
Okay,
great. Let's keep
going.
And
then let's go to the star of the show. Mm-hmm. Besides you, Lady Ada, the customers, the open source community,
the cables,
our team who makes this thing go every single day. Thank you so much, everybody. Let's show it off.
All right, featuring the BMP581. So this is the latest series of barometric pressure sensors from Bosch. They, you know, we've stocked the BMP085, 180, 388, 390, 580. So these are, you know, they've kept the nice affordable price. They have improved the absolute and relative pressure accuracy. Like it's actually, you know, they got a little bit better. You can check the specs. I don't remember. I think it's down from like 50 centimeters to like 5 centimeters relative accuracy when you use it in the highest resolution oversampling mode. They work with I2C or SPI. We've got library code for Arduino. We'll have soon for Python and CircuitPython as well. We're also going to stock the BMP580 and 585 shortly. The 580 is less calibrated, a little bit less expensive, and the 585 has a port on it. But to start, we've got the BMP 581. And so I can look at the overhead real fast. Actually, now that I look at it, like, how does it do pressure? Because I don't see a port. Maybe the port is like so tiny. Anyways, just have it wired up here to my ESP32S2. It's got the temperature, barometric pressure. You know, if I put my finger on it, you can see this is, I have it on like a pretty fast update mode. You know, pressing on it does change the temperature because I'm warm, and it changes the pressure a little bit too. But this is actually the temperature right now, the pressure. I mean, it was a little rainy today.
Yeah,
so
it's super rainy right now.
Yeah, so there, you know, the pressure is a little bit lower than expected, but still, sorry, a little higher expected. Mm. But, you know, these were really easy to get going. They're not firmware compatible, so you do have to update the firmware, but it's pretty easy to just like, you know, you set it up, you can set oversampling, averaging, etc. There's interrupt capabilities. You can put it in ultra low power mode. These are great for low power usage. They're often used in wearables. They're used in like watches and stuff. They're used for drones to do altitude detection. So all sorts of uses for weather and for determining how high up you are, especially because GPS isn't good for altitude measurements because it's off by like, you know, 10 meters or so. So if you want to have precision stability, you'd use a barometric pressure sensor to do that. So check these out. These are really nice barometric pressure sensors. We're going to carry the whole family.
Alrighty, and with that is...